like flowers blooming or animals coming out of hibernation, springtime brings about feelings of renewal. I'm Kelly Sasso with Stitch, which is all about sharing the heartfelt stories from communities like yours that connect us. The tenacity of the human spirit to adapt and grow in the face of adversity, or how friends and neighbors work together to revitalize their communities. These are the stories that stitch together the American story. Today, we're celebrating the ones creating a fresh start, from health transformations to inspiring turnarounds to new life breathed into communities. For our first story, we meet a woman whose medical ordeal inspired a journey to a healthier lifestyle after she went into labor without knowing she was pregnant. Here's Christina Watkins with more.
Like many, Liz struggled with obesity for most of her life.
By the time I was a sophomore in college, I reached 300 pounds.
She became so out of touch with her own body that she went into labor not even realizing she was pregnant, and that was a wake-up call.
The first step was my nutrition. I cut out carbs, I cut out sugars, and I just got more active.
A year later, after dropping 150 pounds, Liz began competing in bodybuilding competitions, but she still wasn't satisfied with her body, and she knew changing her mindset would help.
It's been like a breath of fresh air to not feel like I have to be ready to walk on stage in order to consider myself fit.
So now she's teaching others the lessons she learned through her body empowerment company, Misfit Boss, based out of Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
Obviously, it has the nutrition and the fitness, but we incorporate the mindset. And the mindset is actually the first thing that we dig into, because if we don't realize what we're doing and why we're doing it, then it's not going to be lasting.
And Liz hopes her company and her story will inspire others, because, I mean, who doesn't love feeling good about themselves, right? Of course, attaining that positive self-image can be much more difficult depending on your life experiences. Feeling good can be especially challenging for people suffering through an illness, particularly for those undergoing cancer treatment. This next story shows what a day of pampering can mean to those who need it most. Here's Kelly Sasso.
One, two, three. Hello, gorgeous!
This cancer survivor got a well-deserved surprise, a free makeover. Crystal Merton received a day of beauty from Hello Gorgeous, a nonprofit that provides free makeovers to women battling cancer.
July 13th, I was diagnosed with a right breast cancer. August 10th, I had the surgery.
A mother of four and a grandmother of five, Crystal has been through treatments, different medications, and is dealing with medical complications, but she never lost her spirit, even when she lost all of her hair.
My grandkids and my kids are watching me, and if I'm weak, then they are weak. So I have to show strength for my family.
Her daughter, Christina, organized the surprise months in advance so her mother could de-stress for the day.
That she can relax. Calm down and then just, you know, take a load off. Enjoy the day.
After her makeover, Crystal showed off her new look at a fashion show surrounded by her family and friends.
She's beautiful. Already beautiful anyways, but she's exceptionally beautiful now, you know, with all this stuff that she's gone through.
I feel so happy, joyous, loved, just supported, continue my fight.
Crystal continues to recover while surrounded by her family and loved ones. And as her story shows, a refresh on the outside can do wonders for how one feels on the inside. In our next story, a business in Omaha leaves clients with more than just a manicure.
Nail art is something, as far as beauty goes, that's the one that you do for yourself. Sometimes you'll get your hair done because your mom said that'd be cute, but you could do your nails for you.
My name's Imagine, and I'm a nail artist at Hand of Gold Beauty Room. When people come in for a manicure, they'll bring in inspiration images, or they'll just let me do whatever I want. If they have polish on, we'll remove it, and then we push the cuticles back, shape the nail, buff the nail, cleanse the nail plate, and then apply the paint. The hardening has to be activated by a light, so after that, you can't mess it up. Everything that you would think of when you're thinking of a piece of art, color theory, negative space, contrast, balance, but just scaled down. There's like a lot of different ways you can take one concept and make it into 10. A lot of the art that women have done historically is considered just crafts, even though that takes a lot of skill. Weaving or making clothes or embroidery or knitting. And so people kind of just have to change like what qualifies a person as an artist. Instagram kind of makes the world smaller. You can see nail art from anywhere in the world. So when you have something a little more impactful on the nail, like you can reach a lot of people. People come for the nails and they come back for the conversation. So you kind of create a bond or a relationship that's different than like you would with just like a stranger. I've been with some of them longer than they've been with their boyfriends. It's such a good feeling to have fresh nails. Some of my clients, they'll come in feeling like a total wreck and then they'll leave like they can take on the world.
Welcome back. Just as springtime is nature's way of revealing transformations, in this next segment, we meet people who experienced true metamorphoses in the face of adversity, from sleeping in a park to competing in the Olympics, and from being paralyzed to rising to his feet for the most important dance of his life. Each of these stories teach us that where we are does not have to be where we finish.
You know, I made up in my mind to turn my body into a weapon to kill any doubt that I've ever had of myself.
24-year-old LaDarren has come a long way from regularly sleeping on a park bench after a series of misfortunes left him homeless when he was 19.
No matter how high the sun was, no matter how bright the day was, it was always dark for me.
His journey started when he turned to fitness instead of alcohol and drugs. And eventually, he discovered a place for himself in the U.S. Marine Corps.
Well, you get barracks and boot camp, and you get 3 meals a day.
But his passion for exercise did not end there. LaDarren competed on the next Olympic hopeful, and he earned a spot in the Olympic training camp for U.S. men's rowing.
I went this year, and the goal was to win. I didn't care what sport it was for. I just wanted to win. Whatever you say I'd be good at, I believe you. I'll just train hard.
And for LaDarren, remembering how far he's come adds fuel to his fiery spirit.
You have to. It's the only way to transcend where you are, is to find strength in it.
Training for the Olympics requires being at peak physical performance. The subject of our next story trained for something that most of us probably take for granted.
It was an absolutely perfect day.
Kevin Flynn is the survivor of a near fatal car accident that happened in 2002. It's left him quadriplegic for the past 16 years.
It's too hard to visualize. So I really had to focus on why did I want to walk? The picture that just came immediately to mind was being with my daughter at her wedding.
The former Cincinnati City Councilman and his daughter practiced dancing together for months so that he could share a father-daughter dance with her without using his wheelchair.
And she came in, practiced with me, and we worked on the twirls, and I said, this is gonna happen.
Physical therapists, braces, and a determined attitude helped him stand without using a wheelchair.
I can't believe I wasn't bawling my eyes out the entire time, but I said, no, I might fall if I do that. So, few tears, but they were tears of joy.
Such a beautiful, special moment. Our next story takes us to Granite Bay, California, where a unique ranch brings together people who were broken and hurting and horses that had been discarded and neglected. And together, they help heal each other.
Horses are very emotional and intuitive beings, and they have to be in community to survive. And really, as humans, we do too. Hi, my name is Donna Eckwurzel, and I'm founder and director of Hearts Landing Ranch. What Hearts Landing Ranch is restoring lives through rescued horses. So we have broken and hurting people, and we have broken and hurting horses that have been rescued out of some dire situations, and we bring them together to help build confidence and life skills.
I've been locked up for a few years in my life. I grew up in gangs and drugs, and I didn't have any hope, and I didn't feel like I ever had a future. And I know what it's like to feel as if nobody cares. What made me want to start working here was really Donna's vision. seeing the opportunity that you could use a horse to have a relationship with someone and to be able to build that bridge where someone could find community, to come alongside you and to know you're not alone.
Right now, we're working primarily with exploited youth, foster youth, but really what I've learned is that most youth are somehow at risk for something. And then on the horse side, many of our horses were rescued out of slaughter. They were discarded, they were no longer wanted, they were neglected. The initial horses that we rescued were all local, so we could touch them, see them, see if that was something that we wanted to take on. This last year, we rescued 4 from out of state, and that was a scary proposition. It made me realize what some of these parents are going through that are foster parents or adoptive parents, because they love unconditionally. And same with these animals, we love them unconditionally no matter what shape they come in. Molly was the worst in terms of physical shape and emotional shape. She was very, very, very skinny, barely could walk, was so not interested in food. Fresh grass outside, she didn't even want to eat. We were dealing with some young girls that had been dealing with anorexia, but they couldn't see it on themselves. They could see it on her. Like, how could someone do that to this animal? How is this possible that, you know, she's so emaciated and doesn't have the food that she needs? And that turned the conversations into, let's talk about that for a minute. There's power in being able to approach an animal that's 1,000 to 1,500 pounds, and it brings up for many people emotions at various levels, but then the horse is also responding to those emotions. The biggest thing that the kids learn here is that if you can communicate and find someone that's trustworthy for you and tell them that you need help, they will help you. And that's shocking to them, but I understand that because most people who should have been protecting them haven't.
Welcome back. Achieving the dream of home ownership can easily become a nightmare when accidents, illness, or financial hardships arise. But sometimes you don't need to look very far for help, as these following stories show. They're all about incredible home makeovers made possible by the generosity of neighbors.
The Mikesells were dealt 2 huge blows, black mold in their home and a terminal cancer diagnosis. But thankfully, their community in Orlando, Florida, stepped in to help make their home habitable again before it was too late. After being diagnosed with terminal cancer, John found out he only had months left to live.
And they figured it out around July that it's metastasized up and down my spine and various organs and other places. So the prognosis is said to be bleak.
John's church asked for donations to rebuild the house he shares with his wife and their 6 children.
We found massive black mold in their home. And we as a church decided that we needed to step in and do all we could to renovate their home.
And the church raised more than $20,000, thanks in part to donations through GoFundMe, home improvement brands like Home Depot, Rooms to Go, and Renewal by Anderson also chipped in with donations and services.
A lot of times what happens is God combines the people that need to the people that can do.
All these wonderful people just stepping up and saying we can help, I'm just touched beyond measure.
It's been a few months since our original story about the Mikesells, and so we wanted to give you some updates. We're bringing in West reporter Alex Villarreal to give us some updates. Alex, how are you? How you doing?
Doing so well. Thank you so much for having me.
I know you've been in touch recently with John. So how is he?
Well, he tells me that he would like to say he's terrific, but in reality, he's just hanging in there. He says that he wakes up every day and thinks, is this really happening? He says it's like being stuck in a nightmare. He tells me that the pain he is in is agonizing. He was told that he had 6 to 9 months to live. It's been now a year since that onset of symptoms, so he has outlived that prognosis, and he says he is determined to beat this.
How thorough was that restoration on the house?
They replaced windows, doors, the air conditioning. There's new furniture. And the damage to the house was extensive. John tells me that it started with 2016, Hurricane Matthew. A tree fell on the home in the hurricane, so it damaged the roof. On top of that, their air conditioner broke down and that flooded the entire home. And it was when they went to try to fix the flooring from the flooding that they discovered they had this huge black mold problem throughout the house. And that's when the church got involved, when they found out about this and stepped in to try to help the family. Christina, this was during my last phone conversation with John. He said something that I thought was just so powerful, and I want to read it out to you to make sure that I get it exactly right. He said, "I'm not a victim and I'm not a hero. I'm just a guy who cancer picked a fight with. Either I lie down and get beat up or I fight, and I'm fighting for my family." He's just such an impressive person. Honestly, he's been so inspirational talking to him because his outlook is so positive. Despite the fact that he has this terminal diagnosis, he has such a strong faith, and he says it really is his faith that's been getting him through, and he is determined to beat this, and he believes that he will. I mean, he's still active. He's still working. He is still very active in the lives of his six kids. They are very grateful for this renovation and everything that's been done by the community.
We look forward to hopefully hearing better news in regards to his health and their home renovation. So, Alex, thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And now for our next home renovation story, we're going to go a few states west to Fort Smith, Arkansas.
These men fought in wars decades and worlds apart. But when one veteran found out another was living in disrepair, he volunteered to make some upgrades. And with the help of the community, it turned into a full renovation. Vietnam veteran James Skip Hampton was struggling to make ends meet. He sometimes couldn't even afford to feed himself, let alone fix the home he's lived in since 1962.
There's times that I don't even know where my next loaf of bread are coming from. That's how bad it is. It's not easy right now at all. I'm telling you, it's not.
Skip, a former truck driver, survived a heart attack and broke his back years ago. Now his only source of income is his Social Security. Basic comforts, like central air conditioning, were not on the table, and his bathroom was literally falling apart.
So you have to be careful when you walk in. There's a hole right there. The floor's giving out. It's starting to fall in. There's just water leaking underneath, and it's creating mold, and it's creating bacteria, and the outside elements coming in, water, rain, and everything. I mean, you can see through the wall if you get down in there. It would make them feel a lot better that there's people out there that care, especially fellow veterans like myself.
Former Marine Alejandro Cardenas renovates houses for a living and met Skip while out on a job. When he saw the state of Skip's house, he immediately wanted to help. When Alejandro posted about Skip's situation, hundreds of people offered to help. They wanted to donate supplies and volunteer to help transform Skip's home.
I didn't know the community would care that much, but I'm finding out what they do.
Originally, the plan was just to renovate the bathroom, but the volunteers decided to just go for it and remodel the entire house from top to bottom.
It's just a really old house. We're gonna have to reframe a lot of stuff, and the floor was a lot worse than we anticipated. The electrical was all ran wrong. I mean, we always have to bring everything up to code.
As the project progressed, the need for more help became apparent. Alejandro and his team were calling on plumbers, electricians, and even interior designers. Alejandro and the other volunteers knew, though, that all of this hard work would be more than worth it, just to see the look on Skip's face when they finally revealed his new safe place to live. And after weeks of hard work, they finally got the chance. The volunteers and Alejandro, of course, were there to see Skip enter the space for the first time since the renovation. New appliances, new furniture, and a new lease on life.
I made a house into a home is what they did. My mother and dad that originally bought this house, they would love it if they could be here to see it. They would love it.
It's good to know that the Fort Smith has a great community and people care.
What an amazing transformation and an inspiring act of kindness. We hope Skip is enjoying that new space. Now, what's more of a signal of spring and the approach of summertime than baseball? A small league in Omaha, Nebraska is transforming the lives of children through an activity proving to be timeless. It's time for Sandlot Night.
You're killing me, Smalls. That is the best line, and I bet you kids say it and don't even know where it comes from today. These kids need to understand what Sandlot means. Most kids these days are probably getting home, maybe doing their chores, and then going straight to their phones or their computers and falling asleep on them. So we had to figure out a way to bring those kids back out. Sandlot Night is a group of kids 7 to 12 years old, boys and girls, and it's open to the whole city. There's no yelling from the parents and there's no yelling from the umps. They're encouraging each other naturally.
Baseball has always been that sport where, to me, is this kid's game. We're coaching these kids to be competitive, be good athletes, trying to coach the fundamentals, but, you know, we do stress that, have some fun, you know?
It's good for the kids to socialize at this level because they're meeting new kids. They're playing with boys and girls. They're actually taking into consideration, hey, let's use a softball, or, hey, we've got a 7-year-old kid.
I've been playing baseball for 5 years because it's fun and a good sport.
The parents and adults are actually sitting in the stands in their cars. We ask that they don't participate, but we leave it all up to the kids.
This is working. This is a bunch of kids out here functioning without adults. Sandlot the movie is one of the top 5 best movies ever, probably. It's something we watch as kids. My kids watch it now. My kids can quote it now, you know.
My favorite line is, "You're killing me, Smalls."
So I was watching the movie with my sister. My sister got mad when they say, "You play like a girl."
"You're killing me, Smalls."
It's fun to reminisce on what Sandlot actually means to me and know that I'm able to pass that down to some kids, and hopefully they get just a little bit of what I did.
That Little League is not only keeping an old school tradition alive, but also embodies the community engagement at the heart of Stitch. For more great stories like these, head on over to watchstitch.com. Or if you've got an inspiring turnaround story of your own, email us at stitch@hearst.com, and it might be featured here or on our Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook accounts. I'm Kelly Sasso. From all of us at Stitch, thanks for watching.